back roads in search of something more. Not sure what I was up against or what I was fighting for. Going there in the distance, I saw the signs of life. Now there is no going back. Hope is on the rise. Hope is on the rise. There's mercy for today. No need to steal and borrow, child. Come and take your place. What's done has been forgiven. The old is dead and gone. Grace has brought me safe so far. Grace will lead me home. Grace will lead me home. Grace will lead me home. Yeah. Table free from all my guilt and shame. I might have lost my way, but I never lost a song that led me back into your arms, right where I belong. Right where I belong. Right where I belong. Love came knocking at my door.
Everybody like this. Don't get it twisted here. Because we could do it the other way, which is here. But then everybody would just be clapping the whole time. You guys sound amazing on the claps. Now let's lift our voice and sing some of these old standards. Here we go. Ready? Here we go.
So I'm glad born. When this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Well, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Well, just a few more weary days and then joy shall never end. I'll fly away. Somebody sing it out. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I
stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. There's no more darkness, no more light. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Well, just like a blind man, I wandered alone. Worries and fears I claim for my own. And just like the blind man, God gave me back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. There's no more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. You sing, I saw the light. No more. Now I'm so happy. Amen.
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love. He
Thank you, Ariel. Hey, guys, while you're up and standing, if you don't mind squeezing in towards the middle, we have a bunch of people coming in from the lobby. They had to tie their horse up to the gate, and they're running a little bit late. So if y'all could scoot in and free up some seats from our friends coming in from the lobby, that would be much appreciated. You can go ahead and take a seat. Everybody doing all right so far? Rodeo's in town. It's amazing. So excited. Hey, let me introduce you to a couple of special guests that we have on stage with us. This is Ruby Jane on the fiddle. Thank you so much for spending the week with us. We are so excited and blessed and lucky that you're here. Thank you, Ruby Jane. Over here, this is Jody on steel guitar. This man is literally a living legend, and we are grateful, lucky, and blessed that you are here. Thank you so much. Jody Cameron, everybody. And to my right, your left, is Liz Vaughn with a hat on.
I'm not guys sound amazing. Give up for Liz. She's a little bit country. She's a little bit rock and roll. And I know that you guys are already seated, but I need you to stand up and then boot, scoot, and boogie to the middle of the rows here. We've got a lot of people that are still coming in, and those outside seats make it really easy for the ushers to find them a place to sit. Well, howdy, y'all, and welcome to River Point Church. We are so happy that you came to church with us today. And if you're a guest with us, whether you're right here in the room or you're joining us online, we want to know that you are here. We want to have a way to connect with you. So grab your phone and use the camera to scan this QR code in the seat back in front of you, or it's right up there on the screen. If you want to fill it out the old-fashioned way, flip it over to the blue side, and we got you covered that way. When you fill out the welcome card, we're just going to send you an email to say, hey, thanks for coming to spend some time with us. And here's some things that we have coming up that we really think you would like. But also, y'all, I don't know if you could smell on your way in. Our very own Dean King has been out at the yard and grill working really hard, making y'all chili and pulled pork and burgers and hot dogs and all the things. So if your stomach is already growling and, you know, there's no hungry like church hungry, you're ready for lunch now. You flip it over to this blue side, fill it out, and then take it right out to the yard and grill after service, and then lunch is on us, okay? And I have an update for you. Just this week, our advisory team and trustees announced a date for our membership vote for senior pastor. So we want to invite you to join us on Thursday, February 29th at 7 p.m. or Sunday, March 3rd at the 9:30 or 11 a.m. services to cast your vote. If you can't make it in person, that is okay. Join us online during services on Sunday, March 3rd, and you can cast your vote that way. You can head to rpc.me/pastor for more information about that. Another thing that we've done this month, we celebrated our father-daughter dance here at River Point. We love the father-daughter dance. Those girls feel so special. They're dressed up. They get flowers. Maybe they go out to eat. And memories are made every single year that will last a lifetime. So we're really, really happy to do that every year. And it's y'all that make stuff like that happen. It's your generosity that allows us to love on people right here in Fort Bend County and in communities all over the world. So if you call River Point home, we really need your support in our mission financially and would love for you to set up your scheduled giving routine if you're able. It's very easy to do. You can text your campus keyword to 77977 or grab a giving envelope in the seat back in front of you and drop it off into one of our giving boxes on your way out. Okay, so y'all know it would not be Rodeo Weekend at River Point without what? Orange Blossom Special. I heard someone say it over there. That's right. So we've got that coming up next, and today's message is great. But before we get to all that, will y'all pray with me? Dear Lord, thank you for every single person that's on this campus today. And thank you so much for these people that come in on Rodeo Weekend and share their incredible talents with us. So we're able to praise and worship you in such an amazing big way, Lord. And my prayer today is that everyone's hearts and minds are open to receive your message, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Hello to everybody. My name's Clay. So glad to be with you. I know we've got all campuses with us, Weston, Moe City, the Ramsey Center. I know we've got a lot of people in the overflow right now. And so to those of you that are there, we're so glad you're with us. Thanks for hanging with us. You could have easily gone, oh, it's crowded, I'm going to leave. But you stayed with us. Thanks for being with us. And I hope you'll hang around even afterwards and get to say hello. Today we're going to talk about fighting fair. I love this idea of a series. I thought it was so smart that they were like, hey, we're just going to put it out there. We're going to do a marriage series. And I was telling our kids this last night. They were asking me, they're like, hey, what are you preaching on tomorrow? I was like, oh, we're doing a marriage series. And they go, well, everybody's not married. And I'm like, oh, you know what? You're right. We should probably just cancel. No, I thought it was great. Yeah, the thing is, everybody's not married. We get it. But here's what's going to be powerful about today is that today is not just going to be relevant for those of you that are married, but today is going to be relevant for anybody who has ever been married, ever wants to be married, has hopes of marriage, or for anybody who's just in any kind of relationship, honestly. Because the principles that God has given us for relationship, yeah, some of them really apply to marriage, but the one we're going to talk about today, it really does apply to every single relationship that you have in your life. Anybody like competition? Anybody, you say, yeah, I love competition. I mean, I love playing sports. I love playing board games. Here in America, this is amazing. I mean, we got competitions on television. We've got people who have blown out their Achilles playing some pickup soccer. We've got people that are playing all kinds of odd sports. Like, have you seen tag is on TV now? There is professional tag. This is bizarre. We've made games out of cornhole. We've got all kinds of, pickleball, fastest growing sport in America, kind of crazy. We love even games like the TV show, the house shows, you know, the flipper, the flop, you know, the fixer or the upper, whatever all those shows are, where we've made competitions out of that. Cut food. We got all kinds of food competitions, right? Where it's like, let's see who can make the most out of the ingredients that they've been given. We make competition out of losing weight in America. You know what I'm saying? Y'all remember that show that was on TV called The Was that not the greatest title of a show, right? We're going to find out who is the biggest loser, right? We even have competitions with ourselves. Board games, our kids are really into Uno right now. We got a lot of Uno players. We got a lot of Skip-Bo players. Anybody into exploding kittens? That game, I'm like, I don't get it. Basically, you just keep drawing cards until you get a kitten, and then you got to explode. Like, it's bizarre what we have done with games. Anybody, though, you don't just like competition. You would say you're too competitive. Anybody in here, you'd be like, no, for real. You're like, I've injured someone's wrist playing spoons, you know? You're like, I've made enemies over Trivial Pursuit, right? I was at this church a couple weeks ago. They were doing a staff dodgeball game. I was like, that seems innocent enough. And the pastor's wife was just sitting there watching it. And so I was trying to be friendly and stuff, you know. So I go up to her. I was like, hey, what's up? You're not playing today? And she goes, no, I think I'm good. And I walked away and somebody grabbed me and they go, we've asked her not to play. She was injuring too many people last year. I'm not kidding you. That's a real story. Games and competitions are great for the most part, right? There is an area of life, there is an arena of life where they're not. In fact, they're lethal, they're toxic. They're truthfully to be avoided at all costs because you lose, they lose, everybody loses, right? When we play games in relationships. You got any relationships right now that are characterized by some games? You just know somebody's trying to win. Somebody's always trying to get the upper hand. It could be somebody you're married to. It could be somebody you're dating. It could be your kids. It could be your in-laws. It could be somebody at work, a colleague that is just always competitive. It could be somebody in your HOA. I mean, it's about to be spring, y'all, and those yard people are already thinking. Some of you are daydreaming right now about scalping your yard, punching your yard, making sure to get you ready for the spring competition. Here's what we know about relationships, is that when the games begin, the game is essentially over. If you try to play games in relationships, it will not help you. You will lose, they will lose, nobody will win. In fact, here's a question. I want you to think about this. Ponder this, if you will. What's the win in a relationship? What's the win? What's the win in a relationship? What would you say? Shout it out. What do you think the answer is? What's a win?
Compromise power.
That's true. That's what a lot of people think it is, right? Earlier, a bunch of people said peace, right? Here's what I think. I think the win in a relationship is the relationship. That's the point of relationships, is to have a mutually enjoyable relationship. Have you been in a relationship with someone where you would go, it was not mutually enjoyable? It was not good for me. It was not healthy for me. It did not help me. It hurt me. When you're in a relationship with someone who is trying to gain power or trying to personally win in the relationship, it will not end well. In fact, I've seen it too much as a pastor for 20 years. I've done enough counseling to know in any relationship, typically the most unhealthy person in the relationship will eventually control the relationship. Because unhealthy people are always trying to gain control in the relationship. They're trying to get the upper hand. They're trying to make you feel something. And to win is to lose. And if somebody loses in a relationship, it's really not a win for anybody. If you're in a relationship and somebody's playing a game in the relationship, it will not end well. So I tried to make a list, all right? I tried to get creative, y'all. I tried to make a list of what are the games that we play in relationships. So I'm gonna give you this list. You might be able to add to it. You might have some that I certainly forgot. The games we play, and here's some common ones. All right, here's the first one right here. Anybody ever played the change game? The change game? You know that game we play in relationships where it's like, I'm trying to get you to be different. I'm trying to get you to stop doing the thing you're doing. So some of you got married, and immediately the change game started. They tried to take some clothes that you love and tried to throw them away without you knowing it. Right? Isn't that bizarre? I mean, in fact, that's the most hilarious part of the change game, is when someone is thinking, how can I change him without him knowing that I'm changing him? That's what is like next level change game. But we all know what it's like when somebody doesn't really, they're really in it to try to change us. They want us to be different. They want us to be somebody that maybe we feel like we're not there. Or maybe in some cases they want us to be better. Sometimes they might argue it would actually be good for you. But we all know when somebody's trying to change you, it feels awful, right? What about this one? Anybody know the guessing game? What's wrong? Nothing. I'm sorry, but it seems like something is wrong. Well, if you have to guess what it is, then you've already missed it. And I'm not going to tell you, right? What? Like, what is that? I just know this. My wife, we've been married over 17 years, and it'll be 18 years this year, and I mean, I absolutely love her to death. And we've gotten better at this. We've gotten better at trying to not play the guessing game. But here's what I know, is that I typically can guess my wife's emotions based on the volume in which she is unloading the dishwasher. If it's just like cool, calm, kind of quiet, you know, and I'll jump in there and unload it as well, okay? It's not like that's her job, you know, she better do it. No. I'm just saying, sometimes when she does it, and there's a lot of banging, a lot of pans of clanging, a lot of doors slamming, I know I have done something wrong and I better figure it out, you know what I mean? I heard this comedian, this is the thing that's making me laugh more than anything right now, these days. I heard this comedian, our youngest child, he's 6, and he's really into dinosaurs. And I'm kind of sick of it, truthfully, because I know so much about dinosaurs right now. I feel like it's useless information, it's useless knowledge. And I heard this comedian talk about it. He's like, why are we always quizzing young kids on dinosaurs? They're never going to have to know this. It's not going to help them in life. You know what we ought to be quizzing them on? Here's a woman, I want you to tell me what she's mad about. That is helpful. Some of you were like, I would still be married today if I could have had that information, if I had that skill. What is this woman upset about? Can you figure it out? Here's multiple choice, you know? That's actually helpful. That's the guessing game, right? What about this one? What about the guilt game? The guilt game is kind of like a cousin to the change game. It's like if Hasbro released the change game, the guilt game would have been like edition 3.0. Because it's really a way that we try to change people. If you were really my friend, if you weren't so selfish, if you really loved me, right? The guilt game is something that we play to try to change someone. Here, let me just tell you, let me take one break from this and tell you about how amazingly beautiful and masterful our God is. I don't know what you think about God, but I know a lot of you are sitting here today because the church, and not this church, I just mean like the big church historically, has been really good at playing the guilt game. If you came out of a Catholic heritage, maybe you know this, because it's the way the church worked to try to get you to do what the church wanted you to do was to guilt you. Let me tell you the good news about God. When God wants to change someone, it is not his guilt that he uses. Now, how does God lead us to repentance? He does it through his kindness. This is what we see over and over again in Scripture, that God is slow to anger and abounding in love, and it is his kindness that leads us to repentance. How great is God? If somebody's been playing the guilt game with you, that's not God's mode. No, God plays the kindness game, okay? But if you got a guilt game going in a relationship, watch out. It's going to hurt the relationship. What about this one? The blame game. The blame game is a game that is characterized by the pronoun you. The reason why I did that is because you. Well, the reason why I said that is because you. The reason why I've been feeling a certain way is because of you, right? The blame game. The blame game is incredibly convenient in allowing all of us to smuggle our own issues into the future. I don't ever have to face up to my stuff. I can just blame you in the relationship. Michael Jackson, King of Pop, said, "I'm starting with the man in the mirror. I'm asking him to make a change. No message could have been any clearer. If you want to make the world a better place, take a look at yourself and make a change." What? Brilliant. Brilliant, King of Pop. Brilliant. Instead of all of your issues, he says, if we want to make our relationships better, start looking in the mirror at what do I need to fix? What do I need to work on? What do I need to own up to, right? Not the blame game. No, the blame game is about, oh, well, I only did that because of you, right? What about this one? What about the comparison game? Anybody ever played the comparison game? You know, have you ever been to their kitchen? I don't know why. They just got theirs upgraded. I thought his job was real similar to your job. Like, how did they do that? I mean, my mom, I mean, she that's not the way she makes poppy seed casserole. I don't know what you're doing. I don't know. Maybe that's too much for you to ask. I just thought you could, because my dad could always fix things. Right? Where we're just constantly comparing to another person. But here's what we got to remember about the comparison game. In the comparison game, we're never really comparing to the actual person. We're comparing to a composite, to the best of, to that person's basically, to what they show on Instagram. That's what we're comparing ourselves to, right? We got to remember that. But if you're playing the comparison game in a relationship, watch out. Not going to be good. What about this one? The assumption game. The assumption game, again, similar to the guessing game, but it's when we assume the worst instead of believing the best. It's when we assign a motive to an action, and then, here's what we do. Then we attach, I attach my emotion to a motive that I've assumed for you. How messed up is that? Why are you so grumpy? Well, because I knew that you really didn't want to, and you said it, but you didn't really even want to, and I could tell. And it's like, I wanted to. I never even said I didn't want. What do you mean? No, I know. I can tell. And now you're feeling a certain way because you're assuming an emotion or a motive that I may or might not actually even have. Yeah, that's right. Well, that's a jacked up game. Well, that's the game we're playing right now. So get your characters ready. Get your board out, right? The assumption game, very dangerous. Here's another one. This is when I knew I probably should stop making my list when I got to this one. The family of origin game. This is also similar to the assumption game, but it's when we not just assign motives to the person in the relationship, now we start assigning motives to your mother. I know why she's coming over here, because she thinks that, and that's why, right? Well, I know why they're not coming for Christmas. It's because of this, isn't it? It's like, honestly, it has nothing to do with that. What are you talking, right? I know why they went ahead and went to dinner anyway without even inviting us, and they were in town and didn't even let us know. I get it. I know what they're doing. They've never really liked me, right? You're like, this is all too much. Well, it's because your mom, she's got all that stuff going on, right? It's like, whoa, that game will mess you up. That game is how, I mean, that game alone is keeping a lot of counseling practices in business, is it not? No, see, that's where I decided that we got to stop with the list of the games, right? Because the only way to win is to not play. Let's pray. I'm kidding. Some of y'all were like, for real? That's the end of the sermon? That's called a pastor's head fake. You know, you pump them. Get them up, get their feet off the ground, and then you make your move. No, honestly, I was thinking about it. I was like, we could just end the sermon right there and be like, stop, everybody quit. Don't do it anymore. Just end it, stop. Don't play the games anymore. Let's get out of here. Let's bounce, right? But honestly, if you stopped playing the games, would it make your relationship better? Yes, we all know it. But the problem is that we said it at the beginning. We're all too competitive. We all love competition. Hey, we're Americans. We're Texans. We love to win. So what I try to do is say, all right, if we're going to play a game, if there is a game we're going to play, if we got to reduce it all down to one game that we're all going to play, let's talk about that. We're going to open up the Bible to Romans 12, where the Apostle Paul gives us, inspired by the power of God, inspired by the Spirit of God, he wrote this, giving us a game to play. If you're just like, no, we love games too much. I can't not. I got to play something. He's like, here's the game that you play. You play the honor games. You play the honor games. This is a game you can play in every single relationship. It's a game that only has two rules. It's got as many players as you want to play, 5 ages and up. There are no game pieces. It was introduced 2,000 years ago to some churchgoers in Rome. And you and I are invited along. He says, you want to play it? You got to play a game in your relationship? Here's a game you can play. Romans 12. If you got a Bible, you can turn there. If you got technology, you can open it up. We're going to put it up on the screen. But here's what he says. Romans 12, he says this. He says, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought. This is important that he starts here. He's like, before we get into the actual relationship, I got to talk about the way you're thinking about yourself. Because all of us think about ourselves in comparison to others. And typically, I play games when I think that you need to compensate in some way for me. Because I'm a big enough deal. Because I'm worth so much. Because I'm more important or I'm better than. That you need to figure it out how to compensate for my value. And he says, don't think more highly of yourself than you ought. But let me just also say, some people think too lowly of themselves as well, right? It works both ways. Well, what's the best way then? If some people think too highly and some people think too lowly, how should we think about ourselves? I think the best way to think about ourselves is to think about ourselves like God thinks about us. Do you know how God thinks about you? Do you know what God thinks about when he thinks about you? I love asking this question. I was in a mentoring group with some 20-something-year-olds, and I'll never forget this, because this one guy was having a problem relating to God, and he was talking about how he feels like God just always annoyed at him. And so I asked him, I said, hey, tell me, what do you think God thinks about when he thinks about you? And he said, you know that emoji? And I was like, oh, here we go. He's like, you know that emoji with the hand over the face? I feel like that's how God is with me all the time. He's just like, again, oh my goodness, you cannot get it together. And honestly, as kind of funny as that was, and we kind of laughed about it in the moment, I was like, that's kind of sad. That if that's the way you think God thinks about you, no wonder any relationship is going to be hard. Any relationship is going to be challenging. And I love that he starts here. He's like, you got to think about yourself the way God thinks about you. And the way God thinks about you, let me just tell you, he loves you. He's crazy about you. Listen to this. The Almighty God delights in you. And I get it. Like, hang on a second. I don't want to be like, we're not the kind of church that says, like, you're at the center of the universe. The whole existence of God is just to love you. No, no, no. The existence of God is to glorify himself. The existence of God is to make much of him. But do you know how offensive it is to the creator to think less of his creation than he does? That's offensive to him. So you're not at the center of the universe. All of life doesn't revolve around you. And yet God delights in you. He loves you. He's crazy about you. You're the apple of his eye. Psalm 8, who am I that you would be mindful of me? He loves you. And when you think about yourself the way he thinks about you, you're better set up to have a relationship with anybody. Most relationships begin. The problems in most relationships begin with a skewed view of ourselves. I either think too highly or I think too lowly. He says, no, don't do that. Instead, rather, think of yourself with sober judgment. I love that. He's like, some of you are high on yourself. Some of you are drunk on yourself. Don't be. Be sober about you. He means be self-aware. Be sensible. If everybody were more sober about themselves, don't you think relationships would be better? Because it all starts up in our head when we start thinking that we're bigger than we are or worse than we are, and it affects the relationship. See, most people think if everybody were like me, the world would be a better place, right? If everybody drove like me, the world would be a better place. If everybody could cook like me, if everybody had taste buds like me, if everybody knew what cool was like me, the world would be a better place. Let's read this together. If everybody were more like me, the world would be a better place. Somebody please say amen to that. If everybody in the world were more like me, it would not be a better place. This was the foundational change in my marriage that helped things more than anything else. First couple years of marriage, I thought the whole goal was to get her to do it like I do it because I know what's up. Come see it the way I see it. Come experience it the way I experience it. But boy, was I wrong. When I started realizing that the gift of God was being able to see life through another set of eyes. The gift of God is to be able to see life through another experience. The gift of God is to be able to recognize that, man, we're all snowflakes. Like, we all got different thoughts and opinions and dreams and hopes. I'm not saying there's not an absolute truth. I'm just saying when it comes to the preferential stuff, get on the other side of the other person and go, let me see how you do it. Let me see why you like it that way. Let me see how you understand it. Let me see how you experience it. It's what makes life rich. And relationships, in most relationships, we seek conformity. Be like me, think like me, but rather he's saying, no, 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 no. Be sober about how you think and see yourself. And he says, do this in accordance with the faith that God has distributed to each of you. So he's trying to tell us in Romans 12, verse 3, he's trying to say, look, there is a faith component to this, that when you believe in the Almighty God and when you believe what the Almighty God thinks about you, it sets you up to see yourself better so you can have a better relationship with other people in accordance with the way he's made you. And then he gives us the practical details. He breaks it down for the church first, all right? He uses an illustration, a metaphor that he's used in a lot of other different places, and then he's about to deliver the imperative to us. But first, the illustration. He says, just as each of us has one body with many members, you got a body, your body's got many members. He says, that's the church, that's the community, that's relationships. You got this body that has all these different members. Everybody's got to play a different role. And he says, these members do not all have the same function. Your thumb is not supposed to do what the ankle does. And your ankle is not an elbow, right? And he says, you don't find the parts of the body complaining about it. You don't find the parts of the body being jealous of each other. You find the parts of the body working together, understanding their own role. See, body parts don't try to conform each other to one another. They don't do that. I mean, they support each other by leveraging their differences, celebrating their strengths. But imagine if they started to compete with each other and play games with each other. It would be a nightmare, right? He's like, the church shouldn't do it, the community shouldn't do it, and your relationships shouldn't do it either. No, next verse he says, so in Christ we though many, we form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. This is a different way to think about a relationship, that we belong to each other, that we have a responsibility to each other. The same is true in a church. It's true in a community, it's true in a family, but it's true in a marriage. And then he introduces to us this game to play. He's like, so if you're gonna play a game, here's the game to play. And he closes with this. He says, be devoted to one another in love. Be devoted to one another in love. But he follows it up with something a little bit different. It's almost like as he was writing it, he was like, it's not strong enough. That's too passive. He's like, be devoted, meaning defer to each other in love. But he's like, I got to find another way to say it. And he creates this somewhat tricky Greek phrase to make a very unique point. Look at what he says. He says, be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourself. Be devoted to each other in love, but then honor one another. Isn't that more powerful, more specific? It's more transferable. It's less passive. It's more aggressive. He's like, I want you to try to outdo the other person. I want you to try to out-honor the other person. Get into an honor competition with the other person. You better watch out because I'm about to out-honor you. Imagine the relationship where we were trying to out-honor one another. Wouldn't that be different? Would that not be so different in a relationship if it was like, I'm not trying to get control, I'm not trying to get power, I'm not trying to change you, I'm not trying to guilt you, I'm trying to honor you. In fact, I'm trying to win. Because all I do is win, right? And I'm trying to honor you more than you're even honoring me. I mean, think about military, right? In the honor game, what's the highest medal? What's the highest medal in military? The Medal of Honor, right? What is it? It's awarded for personal acts of valor that are above and beyond the call of duty. We say, you were honorable. In fact, I think it's the only game to play in relationship is the honor game, that we would out-defer, that we would out-serve, out-submit, out-respect. In a marriage should be a submission competition where we're trying to go, I'm going to submit to you. No, I'm going to submit to you. No, I'm going to submit more to you. And the most beautiful marriages are where they are mutually submitted to each other, trying to honor the other person. What does it mean? What does it mean to play the honor game in a marriage? It means I'm going to do for you what I would want someone to do for me. I'm going to like the things that you like. I'm going to care about the things that you care about. I'm going to talk about you in public, in kindness. I'm even going to get to know your mom. Because I'm trying to honor you. I'm trying to honor you. So here's what I want to do. I've tried to just apply this in just real simple, specific ways in different relationships. Let me tell you what the honor game looks like in friendship. You got friends with people, friends at work, friends in the HOA. Friendship is believing the best. It was kind of a joke because they were like, we don't have any friends in the HOA. Friendship is about believing the best. It's about saying, I'm not going to assign a motive. I'm going to believe that you had good intentions. This is the love chapter, 1 Corinthians 13, that we would believe the best about each other. I'm going to believe the best. I'm going to believe that you weren't really trying to get me. I'm going to believe that you didn't really mean what you said, maybe you really got some hurt going on and that's from something else, and I'm going to believe the best. Your friendships will change if you believe the best. I'm going to believe that you didn't mean to leave me out, that you're not, when I keep running into the same thing, I'm going to come and check with you. I'm going to ask you. I'm not going to talk about you. I'm going to ask you, did you really mean to do that? Is that really what, because it felt like you did, and maybe I was wrong, but I want to check with you because I want to believe the best about you. Our friendships, I'm telling you, would change if we played the honor game that way. What about in family? In family, honor replaces obedience. Obey your parents. We're taught when we're kids, right? That works. That works when you're like three and you're trying to get them to put the toy down in Walmart, right? But the older they get, the more we have to replace obedience with honor. And it starts by them seeing it in us, that we're honoring our parents, that we're honoring each other. I'm not just obeying you because God told me to. That's the lowest motive. I am trying to obey you because I want to honor you. I'm trying to love you well because I want to honor you and who you are. What about dating? In the dating world, some of you are out there. In dating, I'll only do what's best for you. This is the honor game. I will only do what is best for you. Can you even imagine what dating would look like? If it wasn't, I'm trying to see how far I can go. I'm trying to work you, trying to manipulate you, trying to get something out of you. Hey, listen, if you're dating somebody and they're trying to get something out of you, get out of the relationship. But if you're dating somebody and they're showing up for you, they're honoring you, they want to do what's best for you, now that's a keeper. That's somebody you want to hold on to. But in relationships, when we decide, I'm going to do what's best for you, I'm going to wait, I'm going to slow it down if that's what's best for you, because I care about you. Last one, in marriage, it's a submission competition. It's who can outdo the other person, who can out-defer the other person, who can out-serve the other person. But here's the thing. In all of this, some of you have been sitting here thinking like, well, you don't know so-and-so because they are not honorable, and so I'm not going to honor him. No, you know this, but the reason why we honor other people is not because they deserve it. No, it's because it's what God has done for us. It's because through Christ, God honored us. He honored us while we were not even honorable. Paul said earlier in Romans, he said, while you were yet a sinner, Christ died for you. He sacrificed for you. He honored you. He cared about you. He believed in you. He gave up something for himself for you. And in that same regard, in the way that he has done it for us, we turn around and honor each other. You want to have a great marriage? Play the honor game. You want to have a great dating relationship? Play the honor game. You want to have a great relationship with your in-laws? Play the honor game. Great friendships, great relationships at work with your colleagues? Play the honor game. Not because they deserve it. No, because that's what he's done for us. In the honor game, the best defense, if you're worried about getting taken advantage of, the best defense ultimately is no defense. So let me just ask you a couple questions at the end. Have you been playing any of the other games? Somebody yelled, yep. That's too easy, my brother. Usually, I just want you to think about it, but I do appreciate you audibly saying you have been. I'm just telling you, the best relationships begin when those games end. And so you got to make a decision. I'm not going to play those games anymore, because nobody wins unless it's the honor game. And so let's play it. Let's be a church that decides that in the honor game, when everybody plays, everybody wins. So, Father, I just ask you, in the name of Jesus, would you give us the humility to see ourselves rightly. For some people, it means they need to see more of themselves. For some people, it means they need to think about themselves with sober judgment. But give us the ability to think about ourselves rightly, like you think about us. Give us the ability to see each other the way you see them. That every person I'm eyeball to eyeball with is a child of God. And God, in every situation where it feels hard or it feels like maybe they're going to get taken advantage of, I just pray you would give them the ability to see past that. You'd give them the ability to honor, even when it's hard, even when it's difficult. And Father, for anybody that's in a tricky situation where it feels like maybe they are getting taken advantage of or even getting hurt, I pray that you would give them the courage to tell somebody about it, to get some help. And ultimately, I hope that we leave here thinking about someone that we want to honor more. Thinking about someone, something that we can do to honor someone well. Thank you for the way you've loved us. I pray that we'll love others in the same way. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.